नमस्कार, वेलकम टू ईपीजी पाठशाला. इन कंटिन्यूएशन विद आवर अदर मॉड्यूल्स व्हिच आर रिलेटेड टू सेपरेशन टेक्निक्स एंड आइडेंटिफिकेशन. इन कंटिन्यूएशन विद आवर अदर मॉड्यूल्स व्हिच आर रिलेटेड टू सेपरेशन टेक्निक्स एंड आइडेंटिफिकेशन
एटॉमिक स्पेक्ट्रोफोटोमीटर.
सो फार वी हैव
डेल्ट विद डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ स्पेक्ट्रोफोटोमीटर टेक्निक्स
such as
atomic spectrophotometer,
spectrophotometry,
and different types of its spectrophotometric techniques.
We'll have some introductory
part. Today we are going to speak on spectrophotometry.
Then its working principle,
its importance.
We'll have some introductory part of spectrophotometry
of different constituents.
Then its working principle,
and we'll summarize
its importance and uses
in identification of different constituents.
And we'll summarize
spectrophotometry.
Term was determined or defined by the Latin word spectron, which is treated as ghost or spirit in Latin, or to see in Greek. With light, you aren't looking directly at the molecule, the matter, but its ghost. Hence the word spectrophotometry was given to it. In the study of interaction of matter with light, we call it as spectrophotometry. That means we are not visualizing the light, but with the help of light, we are identifying the matter because of its interaction with the matter. Hence, the term was given as ghost identification, that is spectrophotometry. In depth, it deals with the measurement of the radiant transmitted or reflected by a body as a function of wavelength. You observe the light's interaction with different degrees or freedom of the molecule. Each type of spectrophotometry, different light frequency gives a different picture, which is called as spectrum, which is a fingerprint of the particular molecular structure or the constituent's structure. What are the targets of the spectrophotometry? Description of the interaction of light with matter and how to use it to quantitatively describe the sample. It is the study of interaction of matter with the light. Spectrophotometry is a set of techniques that can put together in a various ways to fully explain a system, solve the chemical problems. Use of advanced spectrophotometric tools in various environmental analysis are such as air, water, and soil. Nowadays, the spectrophotometer is very widely used to identify the different constituent present in the air also, water, soil, to solve the environmental issues. What does a spectrophotometer measures? As it is said earlier that it is nothing but the interaction of light with the matter. So, interaction of light with the sample means it influences the sample or the light. This involves in two ways: excitation and detection. So, it is clearly shown in figure that this is the sample. When it is interacted with the light, which is nothing but electromagnetic waves, and due to the interaction you have the two kind of results, that is characterization, that is characterized light after sample, or characterizes changes in the sample, which we call as photocaustic specification. This borders on photochemistry. There are other excitation sources also, but we will be focusing on light interaction with the sample and as a result its identification or characterization. What is electromagnetic spectrum? In spectrophotometry, electromagnetic radiation is used to probe atoms and molecules. So, electromagnetic radiations exhibits a wide spectrum and specific range of wavelengths, which have different names as elucidated in the figure. The energy of electromagnetic radiation is inversely proportional to its wavelength, which is very clearly given by the equation E is equal to hc upon lambda, where lambda is the wavelength, h is the Planck's constant, and c is the velocity of the light, which is very common equation. So, here it is very clearly shown that the electromagnetic radiations and it uses in spectrophotometric technique you have a wide range of different frequencies, but our visible range is 400 nanometer to 700 nanometer, which a human eye can visualize. The theory behind the spectrophotometry technique is the light can be considered as a wave, hence we call it as electromagnetic wave. This wave has two components, electric component and magnetic component, which are perpendicular to each other as we indicate by the thumb rule. Electromagnetic radiation exhibits a direction of propagation and wave-like properties such as oscillations. The energy E of the electromagnetic radiation defined as H is equal to H nu or H is equal to Hc upon lambda, the very common and significant Einstein equation, where H is a Planck's constant, V is the velocity of light, lambda is the wavelength and nu is the frequency of the wavelength. Light as electromagnetic radiation and can be described as wave in space and time. The electric and magnetic field vectors are directly perpendicular to each other as it is shown in the figure. The red colored wave indicating of electric field, whereas the bluish color indicative of magnetic field, and it is clearly depicted in the figure. They are perpendicular to each other and moving in the direction of propagation as per the thumb rule. Light and the perception of color is the basis of the theory, where the light or electromagnetic radiations when falls on a substance, that is sample, three possibilities are there. It can be reflected by the substance, it can be absorbed by the substance, or some can be absorbed and the remainder can be transmitted or reflected. The reflection of light is not of interest in the spectrophotometry. The color we see in a sample of solution is due to the selective absorption of certain wavelengths of visible light and transmittance of the remaining wavelengths. A molecule or a substance which absorbs light is known as chromophore. Chromophores exhibit unique absorption spectra and can be defined by a wavelength of maximum absorption as lambda max. Absorption and their complementary color can be very clearly depicted by this small table, where you have wavelength and the corresponding color which is absorbed and the color which is being observed on the other hand as the complementary color. For example, if the wavelength of the light that is falling is from 380 to 435, which we treat as high energy wavelength because this is shorter wavelength, so this will be in the range of violet. So the color observed will be yellowish green, which is light in energy. On the other hand, in the bottom, if we can see the 650 to 780 range of wavelength, which is the highest wavelength, but we treat it as a low energy wavelength, which corresponds to red color. Hence, the observed color will be in the blue-green region. So, this chart helps in determining the color we see and the corresponding color which is being, that means the other side of the color which is being absorbed by the sample molecules. The whole spectrophotometry theory is based on Lambert-Beer's law, which defines the transmittance and absorbance of the light which is being thrown on the sample. So, in the figure, this square box, it is nothing but a sample which is present in a particular area or in a particular vessel. So, absorbing molecules are present in this, either in the pure liquid form or in the solution form. This has a particular length which is treated as L. The source of light, that is electromagnetic radiation, is falling on the sample, which we call as incident light. As we have told earlier, either they are absorbed or transmitted through. So, the transmitted light will be observed by the detector. So, the sample, the concentration of the liquid or the concentration of the constituent present in the sample are the major key points which are going to help that how much the light will be transmitted or how much the light will be absorbed on the basis of the characteristics of the constituents. Suppose the intensity of the light entering into the sample is I0, that is the incident light, as it is clearly shown in this figure, incident light I0, and the exiting the sample is L, that is called transmitted light, only L. Then the ratio I upon I0, that means the transmitted light upon the incident light, which gives an indication of what fraction of light entering the sample is found exciting the sample, and is called transmittance T. So, equation wise we can see the transmittance is nothing, but it is equal to I, that is the transmitted light, upon the intensity of the incident light. Absorbance A is defined as negative logarithm of transmittance T, which is the direct measure of how much light is absorbed by the sample. So, absorbance A is negative log T, that means negative log intensity of the transmitted light, intensity of the incident light, which is equal to log the intensity of the incident light I0 upon the intensity of the transmitted light. So, Lambert-Weier's law can be very clearly depicted. Let's consider two sample solutions of different concentrations, one fairly dilute and the other very concentrated. Because the number of ions which absorbs the light, incident light, will affect the transmitted light which is passing through the medium. So, these two different concentrations of one chemical species will absorb light of a particular wavelength. When we pass a beam of light of the appropriate wavelength through the fairly dilute solution, we could see that the photons will encounter a small number of absorbing chemical species. So, we might expect a high percentage of transmittance and a very low absorbance. Similarly, when we pass same beam of light through the concentrated solution, we could observe that the photon will encounter a large number of absorbing chemical species, and we might expect a low percentage transmittance and a high absorbance. Thus, absorbance increases as the concentration of the sample increases. So, we can say absorbance A is directly proportional to the concentration of the sample C present in the medium. On the other hand, let's have two sample holders of different thickness. That means, this time we are going to vary the L, that is the medium through which the incidence light is passing through. Either it is very thin, that is short path, or it is very broad, that is the longer path. So, two samples holders of different thickness, one with the short path, another with the long path, containing the same kind of sample solution of same concentration, which means the medium present in the container are same, the concentration are same, only we are varying with the length through which the incident light will pass through. When we pass the beam of light through both the sample holders, in the first case the light has to pass through only a short distance, whereas in the second case the light has to pass through a longer time period, it has to encounter the molecules for a longer time period. Thus, that means the light has to encounter the solution for a longer period, therefore, we might see a low percentage transmittance and a high absorbance. This implies that the absorbance is directly proportional to the path length of the beam through the sample. So, in these two categories, what we could analyze is the absorbance is directly proportional to concentration, as it was clearly shown when we are varying the concentration, and in the second case, by varying the sample size, that is the sample holder size, length, what we see, the absorbance is directly proportional to the path length of the beam through the sample. So in GIST, what we can say that the absorbance A is directly proportional to path length L and also the concentration of the sample C. And this is nothing but Lambert-Beer's law. So it consists two observations from which we concluded that relationship between absorbance and the L concentration of the sample present in the holder. So A is directly proportional to C and L concentration and length of the sample holder, or we can say medium through which the light is passing through. In other terms, we can say A is equal to epsilon C L, where epsilon is nothing but proportionality constant, is also called molar extension coefficient or molar absorptivity. It is a constant for a given substance provided the temperature and wavelength are constant. It has a unit of liter per mole per centimeter. That is the Lambert-Beer's law identification. Instrumentally, if we see, a conventional spectrophotometer looks like this, which is depicted in the figure. You have a source and an entrance slit which is passing through the dispersion device. Then you have an exit slit. So from entrance slit to exit slit we call monochromator. That means the source of light, since has many kind of wavelengths, we are going to pass through it through the monochromator device with the entrance slit, dispersion device and exit slit. Then it is passing through the sample, a sample holder present in the sample holder, from which the light is going to pass through and some will be absorbed and some will be transmitted through, which is going to be detected by the detector. In this figure, what we have seen, a schematic diagram of a conventional single beam spectrophotometer. Because what we have done, we have used the monochromator to use the only one kind of beam, which is single beam spectrophotometer. Polychromatic light from the source is focused on the entrance slit of a monochromator, which selectively transmits a narrow band of light. This light then passes through the sample area to the detector. The absorbance of a sample is determined by measuring the intensity of the light reaching the detector without the sample. That means we are going to carry out the blank experiment first and comparing it with the intensity of light reaching the detector after passing through the sample. So in this whole instrumentation, first we are going to use only the medium in which the solution is being made or the ions have been dissolved, which is going to treat as blank. And in the second case, we are going to use the sample itself with the medium. Most spectrophotometers contains two source lamps, a deuterium lamp and a tungsten lamp, and use either photomultiplier tubes or more recently photodiodes as detectors. This design is well suited for measuring absorbance of a single point in the spectrum. Measurement of the concentration of the substance in solution is the most common use of a spectrophotometer. Exact concentrations can be determined in cases where molar absorptivity is known and the measurement is carried out under the prescribed conditions. The substance being measured does not necessarily need to absorb radiation if it can scatter radiation. Since all compounds exhibit unique absorbance, spectrophotometry is also be used to determine unknown compounds, and they can be compared with the standard parameters given in the literature. This technique is also used to measure the enzyme activity in cases where the substrate and the product exhibit different absorption maxima, that is lambda max. Either the disappearance of substrate or the appearance of product over the time period is measured. In environmental sciences, spectrophotometry has very significant role. The commonly found air pollutants in the atmosphere are particulate matter, ground level ozone, carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxide, NOxes, that is NOx, etc., oxides of nitrogen in different compositions. They can harm your health, environment and destroy property. Because in acid rain contents, we have seen that they are nothing but the composition of oxides of sulfur, oxides of nitrogen, etc. So all these pollutants together lead to the destruction in the environment and the existing property, including the human health. Methods for measuring ground level ozone, that is O3, air containing O3 flows into the instrument through a long tube. The air is split into two parts. One stream passes through the ozone scrubber and act as reference. The other stream act as sample. Low pressure mercury lamp act as light source with the wavelength 254 nanometer. Light is passed through both the reference and sample cell. A silicon photodiode at the end of each cell detects the intensity reaching to it. By comparing the absorption in two cells, O3 is measured and detected. Similarly, we have the method for measuring SO2, that is sulfur dioxide, present in the atmosphere. SO2 present in air is sucked by a pump and bubbled through an impregnant into potassium tetrachloromercurate, that is K2HgCl4 solution, to form disulfonatomercurate complex, such as given in the equation. You have tetrachloromercurate HgCl4, where this can be used in the salt form as potassium. When it treats with sulfur dioxide, what we obtain is disulfonatomercurate complex with the liberation of hydrogen ions and chloride ions. Subsequently, this complex is reacted with p-rose aniline dye and formaldehyde to form p-rose aniline methyl sulfonic acid, which is very intensely colored red violet. Concentration of the red violet species is measured by noting absorbance as 548 nanometer. Likewise, spectrophotometric analysis can also be carried out with the water contaminants. For example, for bacterial contamination, the total bacterial contamination of water is one of the biggest concern, and they can be detected by using spectrophotometric technique. Since the standard bacterial testing is time consuming and can take nearly 2 days for a complete analysis, new ultraviolet visible spectrophotometry, which we call as UV-VIS spectrophotometric technique, it utilizes the measurement of light absorption to calculate the concentration of the bacterial levels in the water samples. This technique is cheaper, rapid and user friendly, making it a leading choice in analytical instrumentation of water quality analysis. For chlorine and fluoride quantification also, we can use spectrophotometric techniques. Level of chlorine and fluoride in the drinking water are also major concern nowadays. Chlorine is often added to water for disinfection. Thus, a small portion of the chlorine remains from this process. So, the water must be thoroughly monitored to ensure it is free from chlorine. UV-VIS spectrophotometric technique can be helpful to find out the concentration of these elements for both safety and effectiveness. Moreover, it also offers an effective, easy, non-destructive and chemical-free method for detection. Looking at electromagnetic spectrum, There are many types of spectrophotometric techniques known besides visible range. Many molecules exhibit characteristic signals under this technique and thus can be detected. For instance, variation between the atoms of molecules can be analyzed using IR and Raman spectrophotometry, that is infrared and Raman spectrophotometry. Light can be polarized so that all of the waves are in the same orientation. The study of the absorption of polarized light generally yields more information about the structure of the molecules. If the chromophores have optically active centers, circular dichroism, that is CD, measures the ability of chromophores to differentially absorb left and right circularly polarized lights. Optically rotatory dispersion, which is ORD, measures the ability of an optically active chromophore to rotate plane polarized light. Both CD and ORD are useful in structural studies or proteins and nucleic acids. The effects of molecules on the magnetic component of radiation can also be analyzed. Nuclear magnetic resonance, that is NMR, helps to elucidate the structural information of organic substances, the interaction between the molecules and molecular motion. This method is based upon the principle that a spinning charge, that is nucleus, generates a magnetic field. Further, an electron also possesses a spin magnetic moment, which can be analyzed by electron spin resonance, that is ESR. A common use for ESR in biological sciences is to monitor the fluidity of membranes. A list of several forms of spectrophotometric techniques are as depicted here. You have X-ray absorption technique, UV vis absorption technique, infrared, Raman. In X-ray absorption and ultraviolet, that is UV vis absorption, what we see is change in electronic states. Whereas in IR and Raman, what we see is changes in molecular rotational and vibrational states. The changes in molecular and rotational vibrational states, they do help us in determination. Similarly, optical rotary dispersion, that is ORD, and circular dichroism, that is CD, based on polarized light. Likewise, microwave spectroscopy, electron spin resonance, that is ESR, and NMR, nuclear magnetic resonance, both are based on magnetic moments. Precisely, microwave spectroscopy and ESR on electron spin, whereas NMR on nuclear spin. To summarize, what we have seen is different techniques of spectrophotometry which are helpful in elucidating the different components present in the environment in different samples, and definitely most of the spectrophotometric techniques are based on simple law, that is Lambert's Beer's law. Thank you so much for patience